Ocala's information station, 1370 WOCA. Ocala!
Sometimes you bend, sometimes you stand, sometimes you turn your back to the wind. There's a world outside every darkened door, where blues won't haunt you anymore. Where the brave are free and lovers soar, come ride with me to the distant shore. We won't hesitate to break down the garden gate. There's not much time left today, yeah.
All right, 5 minutes after 10 o'clock, Matt Gibbs is in the studio. He's here to answer your questions about your cars. He's the owner of Sunrise Automotive and the host of this show called Auto Repair with Personal Care. And your phone calls are an important part of this show to talk to Matt, whether it's for a question or just to kind of chat with Matt. The number is the same always. It's the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 352-622-9622-622-WOCA. Good morning, Matt.
Morning, Larry.
How you doing?
I'm tired.
You tired?
I'm tired.
You know, Monday is considered to be the most depressing day of the week. Have you ever heard that before?
Yeah. I've experienced it before.
And I heard this on the news this morning, that this particular Monday, today, is the most depressing Monday of the entire year.
Huh.
Because this is when the bills start coming in from Christmas. This is when you realize that you're making less money because the government is taking more money.
I have experienced this.
There's a few things that are making today especially, but don't let it get to you. You
know, okay.
Whatever it is.
I'm just tired.
You're just tired? Why, you had a busy weekend?
Yeah. We worked most of the weekend, this weekend.
Something like a big challenge? Was it?
No, it was just we were just kind of overwhelmed.
Oh, okay. Just a lot of people. Well, so you need to... I mean, you're on the air every week. You're starting to get a big following, and people are showing up more with their cars.
Yeah,
and
yep. I mean, good. It's... And it's a lot of big jobs, you know, things that take days to fix, not hours.
You know what, I have a question for you. When you drive down the highway and you see a semi pulled off to the side of the road and the whole front of the cab is pushed forward and he's working on it, the guy's working on it, how does that happen? I mean, does he push it forward? I mean, is it a motor that moves that thing forward?
No, it's
that easy to just lift?
Mm-hmm. Leverage.
Huh.
Leverage and it, and a lot of some of them have like
a little hydraulic,
like
assist.
Yeah, like you know how you open your hood and your hood stays open, and it's got those little hydraulic shocks in the front and stuff like that.
Wow.
Yeah, they are pretty heavy though. If you had to pick it up, but they have it where you know leverage is your friend.
And is everything lifting? Is the seat lifting too, or no?
No, just a cab.
Okay.
Just a cab part. Now, some of them, like the Isuzus and stuff, you see them, like a lot of lawn guys and stuff have those Isuzu.
Right.
Those, yes, when you tilt the cab on them, it's like the whole interior.
Everything. Wow. And so I'm hoping that there's a lock to keep it from flying forward if you're stepping your brakes real hard.
Yeah, there's a latch that you have to. Some of them won't start unless it's latched.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. If you took a break for a year, let's say, and got back into fixing cars a year from now, do you think things would change that much in 1 year?
Oh, my. Yes.
Yeah? We're moving that quickly now?
Yes. Well, to be honest with you, there was a time in my career that, you know, I didn't work on cars near as much as I worked on the business instead of in the business kind of thing. And it's just amazing what you know, it's like anything that you do. If you do it all the time and you're doing it consistently and you stay up on your game. And when you stop doing it, it's amazing what you lose.
Right.
You know, just from not doing it.
Oh, yeah. You play drums.
Right.
Right? And I've heard this said about music, that if you skip practice for a day, you'll notice it.
Yeah.
If you skip practice for 2 days, your audience will notice it. Have you ever heard that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm guessing it's true for everything. We do have a phone call. I think I did everything right here earlier. That line wasn't working. Let's see if it's working now. Good morning. You're on the air with Matt.
I must be charmed.
There you go.
It worked twice for me. hey, Matt. Yeah. Thanks for being here. I have a 07 Silverado that the radio is fouling up, and the dealer won't sell a new radio because of the age of the truck. And it has. I was going to get a used radio, and I was advised by one of the salvage yards that has an alarm, not an alarm, but a feature that would prevent one from a donor truck from working in mine until I went to a dealer. And I called the dealer. They want about $85 or $90 to make the computer understand a replacement radio. Do you have anything that you could do that service with to keep me from going to the dealer and paying all that?
Yes, sir, I sure do.
So if... Oh, you do?
Yep.
Okay, that's cool.
I do.
What do you think that would cost to do?
It's like $50.
Okay. Yeah, the dealer wants about $85, and they're always higher. Okay, well, I'll get my radio and get in touch with you then.
That'll be perfect.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
I wouldn't have even thought that was an issue. You mean the computer has to recognize it?
Well, what it is on GM, all of them, GM, Ford, Chrysler, a lot of the newer radios they have, it'll even say right on the face of the radio, anti-theft, and there's a little red light that'll flash, and if you take that, and the reason that they did it is someone breaks into your truck, steals your radio, it's not going to play in another vehicle.
Oh, okay.
And basically what happens is that there's on GM, there's a certain code that's burned into the radio, and then the BCM has to read that code in order for it to allow it to function. So what we can do is we can actually go in and we can allow the new radio to accept a new code from the BCM and allow it to work. On Chrysler, the VIN number is actually burned into the radio, and if the computer doesn't recognize its VIN number, then it won't allow it to work.
Oh, wow. But there's a way around it?
On GM, there's a way around it on all of them. I can only do certain ones because it's just too expensive.
So don't get a car radio from a pawn shop or a yard sale.
Well, you can. You just need to have the connections or know the people that can make that radio come alive again.
Oh, wow. And let's go back to the phone. Good morning. You're on the air with Matt Gibbs.
Yeah, good morning, Matt.
Morning.
I got a family member who is going to be traveling overseas for several months to visit relatives. The car is going to be garaged. Should he be loading that car up with gas and putting staple in it, or doesn't it make any difference?
Yeah, I would definitely put at least, make sure it has at least a half a tank to three quarters of a tank of fuel.
Yeah.
And I definitely would put a stabilizer in the fuel.
Yeah, we're worried about moisture, I would imagine, huh?
Right.
Yeah, yeah. It wouldn't make no sense to run the car out of fuel and have the tank empty?
No, don't do that, and I'll tell you why, because the fuel is actually a lubricant. What year car is this, first of all?
Oh, I think it's an 06.
Okay. Well, then the fuel pump and the meter and all that stuff is in what they call a module. It's one big unit that goes inside your gas tank.
Yeah.
And the fuel acts as a lubricant too. So
okay.
if there's no fuel in it, then it's going to let the fuel pump just sit there exposed to air and whatnot and moisture, and it can cause the fuel pump actually, to not work then when he comes back and wants to go.
Yeah. What about like dealerships and that, where they've got the cars on the lot for sale? The cars might have been sitting there for a year or two, and they probably don't put staple in their gas, do they?
No, they don't. But they don't, a lot of when I worked for the dealership, those cars were constantly, I mean, you look at it and say, wow, that's a lot of cars out there. But they're constantly, they crank them up, they move them, they bring them back to detail, get them washed off.
Okay.
So they really, they might not get the mileage on them, but they do run the engines in them quite often.
Yeah. If you buy a car and let's say it has been sitting for a year or two, and it's a new car. Would it be advisable to change the oil in a brand new car that's been sitting around for a couple of years?
I'll tell you what, a dealer would be really upset if he had a car sitting around for a couple of years.
Well, yeah, it can happen, you know.
I definitely, you know, if it's been sitting there for a while, it's not going to hurt anything.
Yeah.
It's not as critical today with fuel injection as it was back in the days of carburation.
Yeah.
If it was a carbureted car, I'd say definitely. If fuel injection, it's not as critical.
Yeah. So, in other words, like engine oil, if it sits over a period of time in the engine block, it doesn't spoil or nothing.
Right.
Yeah, so it's all right to, you know, to go to use the 30,000 well or 3,000 wells or whatever. So,
right.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you.
You're welcome.
You bet. Bye now.
Thank you.
All right, let's see if we've got another call on this line. Good morning. You're on the air with Matt.
Yeah, one issue with a car that's been sitting a long time is that these computers draw power from the battery even when nothing else is on. And so if you don't start and run the car periodically to get the battery back up, eventually the battery goes dead, then the internal batteries and the computer go dead, and now you have a useless piece of hardware. My cousin had that happen on one of his vehicles.
Yep, that is true. And on some of the cars, actually, if in the fuse box, there'll be like, usually there's a set of two different fuses, and they'll be in a real funny looking yellow connector. And what those are for is when the cars are manufactured, they actually have the fuses out of the fuse box. And then when they come to the dealer, one of the first things you do is you push those fuses, you engage those fuses, and that is there for all its retained accessory power and all the memory, and it brings everything to life. So if you're going to store a car, it may be wise just to find those fuses and either pull them out or pull that little yellow thing out. You know, a lot of the Chryslers have them already in the car, and you just pop it out, and it keeps the battery from draining, because it's not just a computer. There's keep alive memories. There's a bunch of different things that draw very low voltage in these cars.
Yeah, but eventually the computer, if the car is not used for a long time, say a year, those computers go dead and have to be reflashed.
No, they don't have to be reflashed. They have to be, a lot of the cars have what they call adaptive strategies. And what will happen is your car, it may crank up and stall and crank up and stall. And what happens then is you have to relearn the adaptive strategy. It's not a programming issue. It's an issue that the car gets when it runs. You teach it a certain way of running. Okay, and if the battery's disconnected
they've gotten better, but about 10 years ago, my cousin had to get a whole new computer because the thing just went dead from sitting.
Well, that's possible. That's not the norm, though. That's something that just happened. Typically, it won't do that typically.
Yeah. Okay, all right. Have a good morning, all.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. I think you got another call on this line. Good morning. You're on there with Matt.
Hey, this is Bruce. I've got a problem. On my truck, the ABS and the brake lights been coming on off the roll almost a year and a half, 2 years. Does that have any effect, actually, or is that on? I know on the brake it doesn't, because I know the brake's not on. But and driving the ABS off of from not working, or I thought they were mechanically when you hit someone. It automatically broke open itself by mechanics. Is that true or not true?
No, that's not true. The ABS light, if it is on while you drive, it's just telling you that there's. Let's back up here a second. Your brake system consists of two different systems. It still has the normal mechanical hydraulic brakes. Okay.
Yeah.
Then you have
hydraulic. Well, it's not hydraulic, it's a regular brake.
Well, yeah, but you have brake fluid and you have hydraulic brakes. You have, calipers, you have, you know, wheel cylinders, brake shoes, brake pads. You still have the mechanical stuff that we've had forever and ever. Okay? Now, with that, we have a electronic brake system. So we have what we call an EHCU. It's an electronic hydraulic control unit. It's a hydraulic electronic control system. And when your ABS system, when your light is on, that means that there's a fault in the electronic part of your brakes. If you were in a situation and you had to use your anti-lock braking system, it will not function if that light is on. You will have your normal hydraulic system, but no electronic system will work at all. So typically what you do is you bring it in and we scan it just as if the check engine light was on or service soon light was on, and we run diagnostics on just the brake system. And usually it is a wheel speed sensor. Sometimes it's depending on what kind of make and model it is, it may have an issue with what they call a dump valve, an isolation valve. But we have to run diagnostics and find out, okay, why is your light coming on? But I do want you to be aware, if you got into a situation where you needed anti-lock brakes, you will not have anti-lock brakes as long as the light's on.
Well, it's a 2000. There's nothing wrong with the brake system. It's actually the foot brake. Mechanical foot brake, the emergency brake, and that's the one that makes the light come on.
Well, you have two. You have your red brake light and then your yellow ABS light.
Yeah, the ABS and both of them come on at the same time.
Right.
Even, and they've been on, but I've been running it for a year like that, and it doesn't seem anything happened.
Right, but if you take your truck out right now and did an emergency stop, okay? Your ABS system will not function. I can promise you that.
Well, I don't quite get it. I got a mechanical foot brake, and you mean to tell me my mechanical foot brake, that I reach over there when the other brake system don't work and I re-push down the foot brake, it's not going to work?
Nope, that's not what I'm saying at all. The mechanical brake, what you're calling your emergency brake, right?
That's right, and that's what the light comes on.
Okay, there is a switch on your, that is, number one, that is not an emergency brake. If you look in your owner's manual, that is a parking brake, okay?
Yeah.
There is a switch that is connected to the parking brake mechanism, that if you push down the parking brake, the little red light comes on to tell you, release the brake before you drive, okay?
Yeah.
But that light also is connected to your ABS system too. It does two things. It's really telling you get this system looked at, not by one light coming on, but two lights coming on.
Well, I had the dealer look at it a year ago every time, and he says that the basically thing that's very dangerous to be riding around with those lights coming off and on. Is it dangerous or not?
It's not dangerous as long as you're not in a situation where you need ABS braking. As long as you're if there's nothing out there to cause you to use ABS brakes, you have normal brakes like you've had since cars have been out. But if you're ever in a situation, and one of the things that I like for people to understand is, if your ABS system doesn't work, okay, if it's not functioning and you're in a situation where the person in front of you or behind you system does work, you're not going to be able to stop in near the distance that they're going to be able to stop. So you may be the cause of an issue just because you can't stop as fast as somebody else can.
Yeah, well, it's a 2000, GMC truck.
Okay.
And it's been, those two lights have been on, coming off and on once in a while, and I've never seen nothing wrong with the car. The brakes, all everything works perfect.
Yep.
So it's probably, is it a relay or not?
It could be a relay, it could be a wheel speed sensor, it could be an isolation valve, a dump valve, a module. It could be a number of things, and you just plug it into the computer and let the computer talk to you, and I can tell you real quickly What I tell you what, if you bring it by the shop, I'll scan it for you. I won't diagnose it, but I'll scan it for you and tell you what kind of code that the ABS system has at no charge to you.
Well, I sure thank you for that information, because the dealer told me, oh, it's going to cost you a bundle.
Well, it really just depends on what's wrong with it. It's okay. The same thing. It's the same thing, too, with cars with airbags. If your airbag light is on, your airbag will not deploy. It will not come out if you're in an accident.
Is that right?
That's right.
I thought they were worked with a point that when the rod was driven up, it knocked the airbag off come mechanically.
If that light is on, the whole system shuts down.
Well, you mean to tell me that if you have an accident, you have a head-on collision, and your electrical system's cut off, and the airbag don't come on because of the lights on there showing?
That's right. If the airbag light is showing and you're in a head-on collision, it will not come out. It will not.
Oh, kidding. I thought it was mechanical. I didn't know it was electrical. Well, thank you. That was good information,
alrighty,
I think,
sir.
For everybody.
Yeah,
thank
really.
You.
Yeah, I'm with you, Bruce. That was
appreciate it. Right.
Thank you, Bruce.
Thank you, Bob. Bless you. Have a nice day.
And you have another phone call. Good morning. You're on the air with Matt.
Hi, Matt. I could call again. You guys are talking brakes. Is it important or necessary to use your emergency brake every once in a while just to make sure it's working or to keep it in good shape?
Yes.
It is?
Yes.
Well, that's something I haven't done. I haven't used my emergency brake on my cars in I don't know how many years, but my neighbor was talking in conversation here last week. He says, every once in a while, you know, you should use them, try them, you know, make sure that they're functioning.
Yes.
And everything.
Yes. As a matter of fact, especially if you have drum brakes, it's not as critical if you have rear disc brakes.
Yeah, I got disc brakes all the way around.
Okay,
yeah.
Then you're probably good.
All right, yeah. What would be the reason for a drum brake?
Well, the drum brake, there's an adjuster inside.
Oh.
The drum.
Oh.
that it turns the adjuster every time you use your parking brake. So if you never use your parking brake,
yeah,
you never adjust your rear brakes.
When you're testing it, would you like use your emergency brake and then like kind of like put the car in drive and kind of like try to go forward a little bit and force it?
No, I mean, I always mash it. I just mash the brake. And
okay.
If the brake is holding, you'll know, because, you know, the pedal will kind of get hard as it goes to the bottom.
Yeah.
If the pedal goes straight to the floor, then we know we have stuff way out of adjustment.
Yeah. Okay, thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if I could ask you to clear one thing up that you said, I didn't realize this. It sounded like you said the anti-lock brake system helps you stop with less distance.
Wow,
distance. I never knew
and
that.
And the biggest benefit of anti-lock brakes is, and I thank God for them, because the other night I'd have hit someone head on. Someone pulled right out in front of me.
Oh my God!
When I slammed on the brake, and when you slam on your brakes, okay, whatever direction you're going is the direction that you will go with your brakes locked up. You can turn your steering wheel left, right. You could do whatever you want to. Until you take your foot off the brake is when the car will respond to wherever you have your wheel. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So with anti-lock brakes, what basically happens is the brakes don't lock up. They pulse. They can pulse 50 times in a second. Now you're able to steer and maneuver your vehicle with your brake pedal completely depressed to the floor. And it makes you stop in less time, because theoretically you're not going to skid, because you're on and off, on and off, on and off the brakes at 50 times a second.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
So now your skidding is reduced,
yeah,
and
yeah.
your stop time is increased by 60%.
Wow, I never knew that. That's really interesting information. All right, let's go back to the phone. Good morning. You're on the air with Matt.
Hey, good morning, Matt.
Good morning.
Good stuff. A couple of things, you know, and then just listening, I kind of picked this up. You must have a lot of customers that are familiar with old technology, and I am. My truck doesn't even have power windows or power door locks, and I'm sure there's an issue there trying to explain how things have changed. It's got to be kind of rough at points. And the other thing is, it's like, again, everything I own has a carburetor on it. I am so sick and tired of E10, and I hear we're going to E15, I use a product by Redline for motorcycle fuel treatment, but in my Jeep, I just use ordinary stable, and somebody's been telling me that there's a new marine stable formulated for the ethanol fuels. And is there one that you like more than the other? I know you can't really endorse one, but I'll hang up and get your answer on that. Thanks.
Well, the first part of your question is, yeah, we, you know, people still come in today and want their 2007 car. Man, I had a call right before I came to the radio station. Can I come in and get my points and my, you know, and tune up and my points and stuff replaced? I'm like, points? What are them things? I haven't seen them things in a gazillion years.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, people, you know.
Because we just don't know. The average consumer doesn't know.
But, I mean, your car doesn't even have a distributor in it, more or less points.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah.
And as far as the stabilizer goes, you know, the Redline is real good stuff. That was something that we used when we raced motorcycles. We used some of their products. And I guess it's just all preference, you know. The alcohol, I have an open wheel modified car at the shop, and it's an alcohol runner. And I tell you what, I mean, if you let the car sit for a month and a half, you're rebuilding the carburetor, you know. And it's an issue. And Schaefer's actually has some fuel additives and stuff like that that we put in the race car. Just for while it sits, and it seems to be working really, really good.
Wow.
So I would say, you know, if you want to look at something at a product, I would definitely go to, you know, Schaefer's Oil Company, go to their website and look and see what kind of fuel stabilizers they have, and, you know, what they say, everything that they've told me their product does, it's done what they say it does. So
if the light's on, get it checked.
If the light's on, just get it checked. I don't charge for any light. You know, I don't charge just to plug in and see why the light is on. Yeah, I don't go in and diagnose it and spend, you know, hours of figuring. But if you have a light on, you know, sometimes you can ignore it, and I'll tell you. The light's on because this, and you don't. That's not a real concern.
Right, right.
But sometimes the light's on, and I want people to understand if the light is on, the ABS light is on. The ABS system is now defaulted; it will not function. And that's for that's for everybody's safety. And the same thing with your airbag light. You know, the airbag will not deploy if you can have 100 airbags, because that seems like a really big thing when people are looking for a car. You know, does it have side airbags and front airbags and, you know, passenger airbags? And, you know, yep, they do, but it's not going to work if the light's on.
Good show today, Matt. What's your number at your garage?
You can give me a call at 690-1993.
All right, 690-1993. Call us here at the radio station if you need that repeated. We'll be glad to do that for you over the phone. Or go to WOCA.com to the guest list for AM Ocala Live, and you'll see Matt's name at the 10:05 slot and his phone number and everything else you need to know. Thank you, Matt.
Thank you, sir.
Ocala's information station, 1370 WOCA.
Ocala! The weather is brought to you by MyFWC.com. Life jackets save lives. Where at Florida? Times of clouds and sun today. There may be a stray shower along the coast, the high 71 to 75. Partly cloudy tonight with lows ranging from the upper 40s in a few inland spots to the upper 50s along the coast. Partly sunny tomorrow, breezy and a bit cooler, high 67 to 71. For Wednesday, mostly sunny but cool with a high of 64 to 68. From the Florida Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Joe Lundberg.
You're listening to WOCA News Talk 1370, Ocala's source for what's happening in today's hottest, up-to-date news and topics.
They've served our country. They've kept us